worship. Let's just say a little prayer just to get started. Father, in the name of Jesus, we come before your throne. We thank you, Father God, we're able to come together today as one, as your body, corporately together, Lord. We just invite you in, Lord, to come and sit with us and just be with us, Lord, because it's all about you. We're here to praise and worship you, Lord. We lift up our pastors to you, Father God. We thank you, Lord, they're healed and they're on their way to recovery. Father God, be back with us next week. We also just say a prayer for Whitney, Lord. We keep her in our prayers, Father God. We thank you for all you're doing for her, Lord, in the name of Jesus. And for the family last week, the officer Heacock, Lord, we lift that family up to you, Father God. After going through what they went through, Lord, please give them peace, your mercy, your grace, Lord, in Jesus' name. Please anoint today, anoint service, anoint Dudley, Lord. We thank you, Lord, he's here with his wife to give the message, Lord. And we are, Lord, to praise and worship you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Yes.
Father, we come before you. We thank you, Lord, for the money that has been taken in, Lord. We ask you, Lord, to take this offering and do with it what you will, Father God. We pray, Lord, that your money will go further in your kingdom than it will go in our natural realm, Lord. We thank you, Father God, that the lost will be one to Jesus, the sick are healed, and the captives will be set free. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, we're just going to praise and worship the Lord. You may stand, sit, tap your toes, run around. It's all about God.
Come and breathe on the cold.
till it's all that I know. Set me ablaze, set me ablaze, and I'll never grow cold. Set me ablaze, set me ablaze, till it's all that I know. Set me ablaze, set me ablaze, and I'll never grow cold. Set me ablaze, set me ablaze, till it's all that I know. Set me ablaze, set me ablaze, and I'll never grow cold. Set me ablaze, set me ablaze, till it's all that I know. Set me ablaze, set me ablaze, and I'll never grow cold. Breathe, come and breathe on the coals of my heart. A fire started. Please come and breathe on the coals of my heart to keep me burning. Please come and breathe on the coals of my heart. A fire started. Please come and breathe on the coals of my heart. Please come and breathe on the coals of my heart. A fire started. Please come and breathe on the coals of my heart to keep me burning. Breathe, come and breathe on the coals of my heart. Let your fire start. Breathe, come and breathe on the coals of my heart.
Okay.
river. River of God's love flowing through you.
Break open prison doors. Set all the captives free. Spring up a well. Spring up a well. Spring up a well in me. Nothing can stop this joy. We're dancing in the streets. Spring up a well. Spring up a well. Spring up a well in me, yeah. We come alive in the river. We come alive in the river. Bring up a well. Bring up a well. Bring up a well. Bring up a well. Bring up a well in me, yeah. We come alive in the river. We come alive in the river. We come alive in the river. We come alive in the river.
Oh, thank you, Father God. We're so alive in the river. We glorify, we praise your name forevermore, Lord.
Feel it in my bones, you're about to move. I feel it in the wind, you're about to ride in. You said that you will pour your spirit out. You said that you will fall, sons and daughters. So come.
You run, the fountain I drink from. Oh, he is my song. Let the king of my heart be the shadow where I hide, the ransom for my life. Oh, he is my song. You are good, you're good. Ooh, 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 let the king of my heart be the wind inside my sail, the anchor in the wave. Oh, he is my song. Let the king of my heart be the fire inside my veins, the echo of my days. Oh, he is my song. Let the king of my heart be the wind inside my sail, the echo in the waves. Oh, he is my song. Let the king of my heart be the fire inside my veins, the echo of my days. Oh, he is my song. You are good, you're good. Oh, you are good, you're good. Oh, you are good, you're good. Oh, you are good, you're good. You're never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down. You are good, you're good. Oh, 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 you're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down. Oh, good, you're good. Oh, you are good, you're good. Oh, thank you, Lord, for being so good to us. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. You're one to keep your promises. No matter how big or small they are, Lord, you always keep your promise. God of Abraham, you're the God of covenant and the faithful promises. Time and time again,
You have proven you do just what you said.
Though the storms may come and the winds may blow, I remain steadfast. And my heart learned, when you speak a word, it will come to pass.
Great is your faithfulness to me. Great is your faithfulness to me. From the rising sun to the setting, same I will praise your name. Great is your faithfulness to me.
Amazing ways, the word may pass away, your word remains the same. Oh, your history can prove there's nothing you can do. You're faithful and true.
Though the storms may come and the wind may blow, I remain steadfast. And let my heart learn, when you speak a word, it will come. Is your faithfulness to me? Great is your faithfulness to me. From the rising sun to the setting, same I will praise your name. Great is your faithfulness.
So great, so great, your faithfulness through every season I've seen, I will see. Yeah. I'll put my faith in Jesus,
my anchor to the ground. My hope and firm foundation, he'll never let me down. I put my faith in Jesus, my anchor to the ground. My hope and firm foundation, never let me down. I put my faith in Jesus, to the ground. My hope and firm foundation, he'll never let me down. He'll never let me down. Me. Great is your faithfulness to me. From the rising sun to the setting, I will praise your name. Great is your faithfulness to me.
Oh, great is your faithfulness, Lord. Your promises are yes and amen. Thank you, Jesus, for never leaving us nor forsaking us. For never leaving us nor forsaking us. Oh, thank you, Father God. You are my firm foundation. I will build my life on you, Lord.
Worthy of every song we could ever sing,
worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes. Who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me.
To those around me, oh.
no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes and wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation. I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken.
Oh, thank you, Father. Hallelujah. Thank you.
See folks with their heads bent. This is a time just to feel the Lord's presence. And a time for prayer. And if people feel a need to be prayed for, I think there are plenty in this room who would be happy to pray with you. I am mindful that our dear friend Lieutenant Wendy from the Salvation Army is at the ER this morning. We don't know what's going on. But Lord, we just ask for your presence and your peace be with Wendy and Bo, and that you would guide the doctors, that you would bring her to full health. For she is a dear sister and a dear friend. Did I get this? Oh, it is on. Okay. And we're going to need some lights. I actually don't like being in this role because the old classroom teacher is going, okay, I got to do this, I got to do this, I got to do this. So, some of you guys, really only one person really knows Anna and I in terms of our background, and that's Diane, because Diane works with us at the cafe, and she knows us from before here. We actually stole her from out. It sounds better. It's more fun to say we stole her. So, actually, Anna and Diane used to do ministry in the jail every Sunday night. And I went with another guy from Aliquippa. It was kind of fun, actually. We would say to people, hey, I got to go to jail. What? Oh. Yeah, every Sunday night. How'd you get that big deal? Only Sundays? Like, oh, you thought I was serving. Yeah, I'm serving by doing Bible study. okay. Yeah, since like 2008. And we've always been involved in, Anna and I have always been involved in what is referred to as fresh expressions of church, even before we knew what fresh expressions was. So we would do dinner church. We'd set a table and serve a really nice meal, and we'd have conversation around the Last Supper. Read Luke. Everywhere, you know, Jesus is a foodie. He either is crashing a party, being invited to a party. He's partying with the people, the undesirables, and he's partying with the elite, mostly poking the elite and encouraging. And there's always conversation of who we are. And in our ministry at the cafe, because we mostly deal with people, I shouldn't say we deal with everybody, but a portion of our community or people in recovery or people who aren't even close to being in recovery but people who feel very much marginalized, and they have this incredibly trashed image of themselves and of God. They believe lies about God, they believe God lies about themselves. And to talk about what does it mean to be in the image, to be an image bearer, that's the beginning of, I mean, if you to understand what does it mean to be an image bearer, it means you have to end sentences with prepositions. So, rather than preaching a sermon and letting me tell you what I think these passages mean, because how often do we go to church and that's, and then we'll, let's talk about how we apply it. We actually, and then I want to hear what you guys, Anna, my wife has spent the last 8 years in Genesis. So I steal a lot of her stuff.
Not where you're at, because I already have it.
Okay. So what we want to do is read some scripture and then have more conversation. Because this is also what I think is important. It's not that, okay, I do my devotional and this is what this says and, you know, God has a plan for me. Why? Well, because this is, I know I, we lift stuff out of context and claim that this is it for me. This is what this means. And so how do we approach scripture as a community, but also trying to bear in mind how did the original readers, how did first century Jews, how did, you know, to whom it was originally written? I'm trying to do a couple of things. What else, what do you bring to the table today? What is your understanding of what does it mean to be in good there? So you had a question. You've got better handwriting than I do.
This is not, we might be crossing. This has a ton.
I hear you. I'm just louder.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Oh.
I hear you well.
The only reason I need it is because we're live streaming and otherwise I wouldn't care. As we read the passages, it becomes important to read across translations, because the reason it's things are translated the way they are in different Bibles is because of the person who translated it, their point of view. And if we're only sitting with one point of view, we're sitting in the wrong place, because there the facets that are in Scripture, the facets that, I mean, how many different ways can you break down a parable? Just a parable. I mean, just a short little story, and have 20 million different meanings, but they all have to agree with the original meaning. They can't, you can't just make up your own meaning and say this is it and that's where we're going. Everything has to be measured against the way it was written and who it was written to before you can then take it out and use it in different areas. So that's the reason that reading across translations is so important, because you want to change your point of view so you don't get stuck with, okay, this is the way everybody's always read it, and this is the way everybody's always understood it, and there's never an aha moment. There's never a moment where you go, where you actually hear from God and go, oh, that's what you've been telling me. So that's me. What do you got?
I'm going to start. I've got ESV.
And
we have another mic that we'll share around so that we can get everything on the for the live stream. I like your two Bible choices, by the way. I have Holman, and I regularly am in the Holman and the ESV. But over here, this is the Eastern Shore version. Even though there's a lot of King James only folks, there is. And I brought my study Bible, but then I realized that the print's not as big. So I'm just going to start in Genesis 1. I'm going to start in the beginning. If you want to follow along, and you might, if you've got a different translation, pay attention to where there are some, if there's a difference that sort of, wait a minute, that's not, those are things to note. The other thing that we want to listen for are repetitions. Right? If a phrase gets used multiple times, it's usually there for a reason. And then the other thing, what sounds strange? What sounds, wait a minute, that doesn't make sense. The things that doesn't make sense. The things that, you know, that we'd like to push aside. Like, okay, I don't want to deal with that. No, we really need to deal with that. So Genesis 1. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was without form and void, and darkness was over the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the waters. And God said, "Let there be light." And there was light. And God saw that the light was good. And God separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning, the first day. And God said, "Let there be an expanse in the midst of the waters, and let it separate the waters from the waters." And God made, and it was so. God called the dry land earth, and the waters that were gathered together he called seas. And God saw that it was good. And God said, "Let the earth sprout vegetation, plants yielding seed and fruit trees bearing fruit in which is their seed, which according to its kind and on the earth." I'm sorry, and to its kind on the earth. And it was so. The earth brought forth vegetation, plants yielding seed according to their own kinds, and the trees bearing fruit in which there is their seed, each according to its kind. And God saw that it was good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the third day. And God said, "Let there be lights in the expanse of the heavens, so to separate the days, the greater light to rule the day, and the lesser light to rule the night, and the stars." And God made them in the expanse of the heavens to give light on the earth, to rule over the day and over the night, to separate the light from the darkness. And God saw that it was good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the fourth day. And God said, "Let the waters swarm with the swarms of living creatures, and let birds fly above the earth, across the expanse of the heavens." So God created the great sea creatures and every living creature that moves, with which the waters swarm, according to their kinds, and every winged bird according to its kind. And God saw that it was good. And God blessed them, saying, "Be fruitful and multiply, and fill the waters and the seas, and let the birds multiply on the earth." And there was evening, and there was morning, fifth day. And God said, "Let the earth bring forth living creatures according to their kinds, livestock and creepy things, and beasts of the earth according to their kinds." And it was so. And God made the beasts of the earth according to their kinds, and the livestock according to their kinds, and everything that creeps on the ground according to its kind. And God saw that it was good. And now this is where we get to image bearing. Then God said, "Let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the earth, and over every creeping thing, or creeping things that creep on the earth." And so God created man in his image. In his image, God created him. Male and female, he created them. Then God said, "Let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the heavens, and over the livestock, and on the earth." And so God created man in his image. In his image, God created him, male and female. Then, "Be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the heavens, and name a living creature." And the Lord God planted a garden in Eden in the east, and there he put the man whom he had formed. And out of the ground, the Lord made to spring up every tree that is pleasant to the sight and good for food. And the tree of life was in the midst of the garden, and the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And skipping down to 18. Then the Lord God said, "It is not good that man should be alone. I will make him a helper fit for him." Now out of the ground the Lord God had formed every beast of the field and every bird of the heavens, and brought them to the man to see what he would call them. And whatever the man called them, every living creature, that was its name. Man gave names to all the livestock, to all the birds of the heavens, and to every beast of the field. But for Adam, there was not found a helper fit for him. And so the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon the man, and while he slept, took one of his ribs and closed up his place with flesh. I want to interject here that rib is really probably the worst translation. It's the only place we use the word, and it has traditionally become rib, but it really is like opened up his whole side, like took half of him. We have held on to this tradition of it being a rib, my spare rib or whatever. It is, woman was made from much more of man. In essence, he split Adam and formed two people from the one, kind of like a sponge ball trick. Saw it in half and you now have two. And the rib that the Lord God had taken from the man, he made into a woman and brought her to the man. And then the man said, "This at last is bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman, for she was taken out of man. Therefore a man shall leave his father and his mother and hold fast to his wife, and they shall become one flesh." And the man and the wife were both naked and were not ashamed. There are a couple of things going on, and I just wanted to pop back to that one piece, because tradition has held that it's this rib. The other piece that's in there is this idea of helper. Azar. we translate it as helper here, but every place else you look for that word, it's rescue. It's a savior. There are places in the Old Testament where it speaks of God as Azar coming to the rescue. So it's also like the word ministry. We sometimes translate it as service, and sometimes we translate it as ministry, depending on whether we hold it as something special or whether it's just everyday things. And I think, again, that's our modern translation, working with those words in that way. So, thinking of Azar as helper, no, as rescuer.
Well, it becomes important to understand what was she there to help him with, because there were, you know, people get the idea, oh, well, she's supposed to keep the house and the laundry. Well, there was no house, there was no laundry, there wasn't anything to cook.
They're gardeners.
So, yeah. So it is not to translate it as simply a domestic, which is what it gets put to, does a disservice to the fact that, you know, if we're created in his image, then, and God is neither male nor female, but both and, because you can't have female without male, and because the whole thing is just kind of ridiculous that he would make this meek little thing that their only purpose was to wash clothes and cook food. That's when you're talking about subduing the land and doing the things, she's got to have his back. She's got to be as strong as he is in order to accomplish what it is that what each one can't do alone, separately from each other. It's the completion.
Right. So we've said more than intended to say to start with. What'd y'all get? And I got a microphone here. Don't be shy. Thoughts?
Something that's interesting. It's just a little different direction than what you're talking about, but right before he made man, I think it's interesting that he says that man is being made in our image. I think that's fascinating that the Trinity, the Holy Trinity, was there in the garden together. You know, everything talks about God, and then once he gets to making man, it's in our image.
Correct.
So it's not really along the lines of what you're talking about,
but
it is.
That's important.
It is, and it's very important because it shows that God has always lived in community. And so if Jesus came to reveal the church, then he came to reveal that the church has always existed because God has always existed in community. It's always about relationship. And so that's very, very important, because we miss that and then we feel like we don't have to be community. But that's the design. That's the way we were created. That's because that's who created us. So yeah, that's very important.
I think it's easy to gloss over because that's the only time he mentions our image.
Right.
So if you don't pay attention to it, you know, it's easy to get glossed over.
Right, and we get used to the idea that we've read it so much that we don't pay attention to a lot of things because, oh, we know that.
We want to rescue.
So I don't have to read it.
We want to rescue real meaning from familiarity. Because
right.
We read these things like, yeah, well, I know what that says. And I just want to come to this piece, you know, so that's back in 1:26. Then God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness. And if you skip down to 27, it's actually a poem. It's Hebrew poetry there. This idea of, you get these couplets where A plus B, or A more so than B, or A not B. This is a A plus B. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. And that actually, I think, is a plural. Male and female, he created them. And, you know, Adam actually means soil, dirt. We are humans because we are, you know, this is where we also get the word humus. We are dirt people.
Not to be confused with hummus.
Right. But we are. We are dirt people. And by the way, I'm going to, what does anybody else have? Or what does anybody, and push back, feel free to push back. This is how we read scripture in community. And if we go, oh, no, they're up front. They have the microphone, so they must, no, don't demur, please.
Let's not forget that the apostles argued and fought down as they traveled down the road. They did not agree on everything, and you know,
he loves me more.
Yeah. No, I get to sit on the right hand. No.
So
we forget that comity is something that is here, not they didn't have all of that. They were fishermen, so, for crying out loud, and they were used to bargaining and wheeling and dealing, and it was because it was all based on trade. So that's anyway. What they, and oh, by the way, they were Jewish, and there's it's not about an argument. It is just the way they communicate, because they push back and push back because they want to go
test.
To the edges of the envelope. So
Hispanics are like that too.
Oh.
And then we eat.
Yes. Same everybody. Good food.
I really appreciate how you put like us females in the same. Oh, it's okay.
No, no. This is for the home audience.
There you go. How we are the same value as our husbands. As
exactly.
The man.
Exactly.
And through scripture, we'll see that two are better than one. It's not one submit more to the other. We should both be submitting to each other.
To God. And see, because.
Oh, wait a minute. Hold on. There's an echo there.
An echo?
You said submitting to each other. Where else do we hear that? Ephesians.
Yeah, that's right.
Husbands, be submitted to your wives. Wives, submitted to your husband. It's not one or over the other as much as it's to each other.
Well, they don't get to the part that says, oh, husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church.
Wash her with the word of God.
Exactly. Exactly. Well, and the other thing is, how did Christ love the church? He didn't just die for the church. He did not die for his bride. He actually had to rise again in order for that to mean anything. But in order for him to honor his bride, he had to lift her up and give her a voice. That's not sit down and shut up. Because Jesus actually had to, he was here to lift up the church and to give the church a voice. And if that's how Jesus loves the church, that's how husbands should love their wives.
Other things? Ephrain. Amen. Sorry, I just caught. Yeah, you need a mic.
Okay.
Here. Have a seat.
So I would actually say that, well, really to get back into the man and woman, Adam and Eve, I would say that's sort of like a shadowing towards the church, I guess, because you have man and then you have, woman, they're given into marriage and they're in paradise. And then things get screwed up. And in the way later in the Bible, you have Jesus talking about the bride and the bridegroom, and how in the end it's going back into paradise. The bridegroom is taking the bride up to paradise. But the bridegroom already exists before the bride, I guess? I don't know. But I don't know. I feel like a lot of things in Genesis shadow a whole lot more.
They absolutely do. You're
exactly.
Spot on.
Exactly.
It's also why it's important. And part of what we're trying to do is biblical theology. You know, what are the themes that weave through from the beginning to the end? And where are the foreshadowings? So, yeah, the parable of the 10 ladies waiting for the prince to come, and some of them aren't ready because they don't have enough oil. I mean, there's lots to mine in that. There's lots of these echoes, and there's most of it's relational and about the kinds of relationships we're supposed to have that should be mirroring God. But I also want to just come back to our kind of question, what does it mean to be made in the image of God? Because I know the rabbit hole will go down. Who's boss over who? Because isn't that what, I mean, that's human, right? You're not the boss of me. And we turn around and do the same thing to God. It's like, I got this! So, I want to come. Yes. Oh, good.
I'm kind of going back to, I guess, the biblical view instead of what the world wants to throw into this. Kind of like we listened to your pastor talk about from last week, I think. We were listening to,
okay,
I think, his message from last week. But, I mean, just going back to the rib thing, I don't know if there's any other translation that doesn't say rib. Does rib mean?
It's actually a hapax legomena. To drop a theology term.
Yeah, go ahead.
It is the only place where the word is used here.
Right.
And it became tradition 300-400 years. It became a way of reading it, but there's more to it than just a rib. That's the way that, you know, when the word gets used elsewhere. It's the only place it gets used in Scripture, as I understand. And I'm not a Hebrew scholar. If you want to go in the Greek, I'm better in the Greek.
To me, all the Scriptures say rib, and to me that's not a bad connotation, that it's a rib. I mean, we're kind of jumping up forward to Ephesians, and these divisions and stuff, I don't think it's divisive, even if it was a rib, whether it was
right.
Half or whether it was a rib. The fact, the fact that it came, that woman was made from man, and there are places in the Bible, man is to be over the woman, but we're supposed to be equal. So it just seemed like we were trying to go.
The context on that, we could argue that the context of where those passages are, those are written for specific places. For specific communities.
And this is just talking
this
about
is
creation,
not
the,
right?
Right.
Yeah, this is, and
was,
so that's, yeah.
I didn't know
and,
how you were jumping forward to all of this.
No, we just kind of.
Creation. Okay, that's why I was confused.
This is where we live,
yes,
in these passages.
We live in all this. But the most important thing is that.
It was the order is that I was talking about, the order of things that God created man. The woman was created from man by God. And I thought that's the direction we were going. And then
yeah.
It seemed like we were starting to talk about divisions and stuff, and I was
No. Because the most important thing is that he didn't go find another pile of dirt or make her out of a tree or something else.
Right.
She's made from the exact same material.
Same substance.
From him. The substance is he didn't go find something else to create her from, to make her from. Yes. And so that's the most important thing.
And just that there is equal.
Yeah. Exactly.
Well, and there's.
I wasn't inferring that we were unequal. I didn't know how you're
right.
Reading all this.
Oh no!
From the Bible says.
Which is
right now.
Which is
some.
Bible, that's what it is.
Right.
Which is important to have the discussion, because it clears things up.
Right, and this is why I say thank you for, and I want to say thank you for the pushback, because yeah, we can spin off in these things. Well, no, they said that. Like, no, we're not the.
Because it was a rib.
Right, and there is, and you're going to make me go back and look this up,
okay.
But there's a midrash.
Here's the thing, the world can only provide sort of even. Only God can provide equality. There is no equality without God. And so the best that the world can do is kind of sort of even, and it's not very good at even that. So in reference to anything that has to do with this world, I'm not worried about anybody else because they can't take from me what God gave me. And so however they want to jockey for position, that's on them. It doesn't have anything to do with me. So that's my stand on it. And if somebody wants to say they're over me, well, go argue with God about that, because I'm not into it.
Yeah.
Just not.
There's a piece in this too that people run to Ephesians a lot. We got to remember that Ephesians in Ephesus was the cult of Diana, yeah. And the women had actually been the leaders in the temple, and they had all this other. They had a whole lot of stuff they needed to unlearn, and so y'all need to sit down and learn for a while. I mean, that's one of the pieces in Paul, and we can go and have those. I want to come back and stay focused on image. I would, if you don't know Ken Bailey, works of Kenneth Bailey. He was a Presbyterian missionary seminary professor who lived most of his life in the Middle East. And some of the stuff I pull forward is actually because he has brought forward the Middle Eastern voices. It was. So it isn't just our Western European understanding of Scripture, because we're reading English Bibles and that all comes through the Western track. So I'm pulling in some scholarship that's Ken Bailey stuff that who we both knew. And anyway, I can give you references if you want to do more digging. Trying to stay back. What does this mean to be made in the image? Ephraim. Hey, my friend.
So I was being late. I guess I wanted to ask, Brett, the rib thing where the woman was, where the rib was pulled out of man to make woman. I guess someone said it in a joke. They said so I guess when the men get married, the women are like, be a pain in their side.
Okay.
I'm just kidding. That was just an old joke. Thank you. I'm here all week. Anyway, I think it has to do with being married when. Okay, wait a minute. I won't mess the thing in hand. You was talking about. Men being made in God's image,
right? Male, like, and female.
Yeah, male, female. Well, I was kind of confused at one point because I was thinking was made in man's image. So would it mean that God is man? I mean he's male, like, or whatever.
Okay.
You know.
We're going to get, let me address for a second and take some of that. We're going to get into some difficulties. We're going to try and say that, trying to break God down into masculine and feminine, the way we look at one another. I mean, clearly Scripture uses he and him for God, for Jesus, for the Holy Spirit. But it's really tough to think of God as man or woman. In the sense of the way we look at each other, the only part of the Trinity that I have an image of as being truly masculine, truly a male, is Jesus. Right. So, in some respects, our language, our limitations of our material, physical experience, and our language limits how we can really talk through that. The important piece is that God says, "Let us." So God is speaking very much in a plural. It's not a royal we. Hey, I think I ought to do this. Let us make man. Let us make humankind in our image. Male and female, he made them. And there's that little poem, that little piece of Hebrew poetry. So we're the image bearers. I want to run to something that I'm... some of the folks I listen, there are a couple of people that we study that I listen to. Len Sweet actually talks about God, you know, making man. Literally, he throws him, you know, like he threw himself on the ground to make the image. You know, made a mold of himself. Okay, that one presses for me a little bit. But the Bible Project, if you know those guys, and they do some talking about this stuff. The temple, the Garden of Eden, and the discussion of Garden of Eden itself is like a temple. God is making a temple. And the last thing that you put into the temple, into any temple, right, are images of the God. And so God then, you know, so God makes the temple, and he puts Adam and Eve as the image bearers. Why does God not want us to make idols? Idols, which the word is the same, idol, image, same thing. Why do we not make idols? Because God has already made the image for his temple. It's us. Male and female. Can't do it alone. It's the two of us. Or it's the all of us. Because each one of us is an image bearer. So what is that? We're all parts of the body. There's that all parts of the body piece. But in each individual one of us, just like in the cells of your body, in every cell of our body is all of the stuff to be the whole body. Right? The DNA, the code, is in every cell. Except for red blood cells, because they kick it out so they can carry oxygen. Once they're made, they're... Former biology teacher, sorry. So each one of us, even though we are all different, we all have different giftings, right? Different parts. Each one of us, though, in ourselves is complete as an image bearer. Whether I'm male or whether my wife's female, we're all image bearers. What does it mean? What does it mean to be created in the image of God?
I mean, I understand we're all made different, but I think maybe it's more of a mind thing, mental thing to want to, I guess, to be like the Creator as far as, you know, as far as wanting good and doing good and being good, and to basically spread that mindset okay. to everyone else.
I'm going to pick on you for a second because I know you. Part of why Ephraim was late getting here is because he's a resident with about six other churches. Ephraim is one of these people where he doesn't even have to watch you play something. He just hears and says, okay, I got this. And by the way, I can riff further on that and do all the, I mean, Ephraim is a talented piano player. So God has gifted you, but as an image bearer, right, you also have a creative side. And you create musically, beautifully, all the time. Jokes, maybe not so much. But.
Get out.
That's my job. Jokes are my job. We've been knowing each other for a few years now. But, so there's a creative piece that, and I envy your gift, because nobody asked me to sing more than once, and that's just singing. Notice I stepped as far away and this was not on.
What does it mean to be made in the image of God is so yeah. deep, because he's made each of us different and unique in our own ways, with mm-hmm. different passions, different loves, different purposes, and God is so big that he encompasses all that because he gave us a little piece of himself in every way. So, I mean, that's one of the probably hardest questions you could actually ask, but in a way, the easiest question, because you can look at humanity.
But, and I'm going to take it more personally. What does it mean for you, each one of us here, what does it mean for you to be made in the image of God, to be that image bearer?
I mean, I always look at it as being a father with my sons. That's the closest thing I can get to even fathoming what God has done, and to think that they're just a little piece of me. And I'm not perfect by any means, I'm far from it, but I want them to have all the good parts of me. So to me, I think God wants us as humans to have all, and he is all good. There's no evil, there's nothing bad about him, but I want them to have the good traits of me, you know, and better. And I kind of think of God like that. I always think of God the Father as, to me, as I am to my kids.
The good, good Father.
He's much better.
It's just one of those, right? You're a good, good Father. Sorry. Yeah.
One of the things that that came to me this morning as I was sitting out in my prayer chair was that the idea, the even and equal thing, the man who goes and hires the workers in the morning and says, I'll give you X amount, and then he goes out at noon and X amount, and at the end of the day, they all get the same amount, and the ones that worked all day are really upset because that's what you agreed to. That was the agreement. And so even and equal comes in that wherever we jump in the river, wherever we jump in the stream to go along with God's plan, that's where we are. And we meet people who jumped in the river way, way, way back. I mean, they've always been. And like the older son of the prodigal son story, it's not fair. It's not fair. You're treating, you won't even let me have a calf for my friends. And you're throwing this big party for this kid who wasted everything. He just squandered half of what you own. And we tend to not see that it doesn't matter where we jump into the river. It doesn't matter where we get it, that we understand. We all get the same inheritance. It's all the same. And we want it to be fair according to what our experience in the world, because we were good. I was good. I deserve more. No, you deserve what is what God says. And so for me, being an image bearer is recognizing that I don't get to say that somebody else is, okay, I'm not smarter than everybody. I'm not, you know, I don't know everything. I may have it up on obedience on a lot of people, but the thing is that it doesn't, none of those things matter when it comes to God's doling out the inheritance. It's not divided, it's multiplied. And so we each get the same thing. And the same is this, the inheritance is the universe. We all get that. And we need to stop fighting over who is more important, who gets to say, because this is why I like doing the whiteboard. This is why I like having the discussions, because a lot of people have sat mute, and they have so much wisdom. There is so much that people have, the experience that God has with these people. I don't have it. I want to hear that. I want to know. I already know what I know. I don't need to keep saying what I know. I need to hear what other people know and how other people experience it. So that's being an image bearer for me.
She's also a fabulous cook. I was skinny once. I am a blessed man, and I know it.
For me, it's great. God's been really, like the season, especially for this COVID, just, thank you, just grace, having grace, because that's what God, that's who he is, he's grace. And I love when Paul says, remember, you too were in that darkness. You too were that. And it's true, sometimes when we read a lot or we pray a lot, or in ministry, we feel, oh, we're here. And I have to always remember that, you know, that grace and the mercy, because we were there. We were in the darkness. We're no better. But God has been really just the grace, and it's so hard because it's so painful. It's just painful. But, yeah, for me, it's about grace, because I stand by grace alone right here, right now. So I have to keep asking for more and more.
Seth, did you still have a... Seth in the sound booth, folks. He's making it work. You're good, man.
So like you guys were saying, some things in the Bible are meant for specific people. I would say an alternative is being made in the image of God being for specific people. Now, I'll be honest, I have not read the Bible cover to cover. I'm still working on that. But from what I understand, there are three people who are mentioned as being the image of God: Adam, Eve, and Jesus. Adam and Eve, before the fall, they were sinless. Jesus was also sinless. So I would say that being made in the image of God may not just be physical, but like you guys were saying, also on the spiritual side. Being sinless, you are righteous, morally perfect. You have no flaws, basically, because there's nothing that can really happen that's bad. We're also able to create, but on a much smaller scale than God can, because, you know, I can create a pencil, but hey, he created the universe. Actually, you can't create the pencil. That was a bad example.
You can plant a garden.
Yeah. I lost my train of thought. I know tonight I still lost my train of thought.
I hate that. Yeah. Train of thought left the station without you.
Yeah. Just spiritual, I guess, more than physical.
Well, no, it's the idea of being an image bearer. It isn't just those three people. For me, the idea of image bearers, and that I recognize in everybody else that they are also image, you know, bear the image of God, means that I can't kill them, even though they really deserve it in my own judgment. Right? And so in some respects I have to treat people differently. And that means everybody. And you want to jump someplace on a larger scale. Jesus talks about unity a lot. Paul talks about unity a lot. God talks to the people of Israel and says, it's through you I'm going to do this for the whole world. Huh? What? Right? And so instead of us and them, us who are smart enough to be here today, those who didn't get in here, right? Those of us who believe in Jesus Christ as Son of God, Savior, and those heathens who believe something totally different because they're wrong, right? I mean, we can get into those things really easily. Or women, sit down, shut up, we got this, right? Yeah, okay. I'm glad I don't ever have to do childbirth. Just going to say, I'm happy that there are things that I don't get to do.
We would have half of the population.
We'd have gone extinct a long time ago.
So, sorry, I didn't mean to get too carried away with that one. But just the idea that everybody, every human being bears the image, is an image bearer. And therefore, they have a character, a quality that I have to honor. I have to give reverence to. And so, and this is Greg, Father Greg Boyle, if you know him, with Homeboy Industries in Los Angeles. He talks about, you know, and I think this actually came to him through Mother Teresa. You know, we've forgotten that we belong to one another. You know, imagine a circle, and that circle gets bigger and bigger so that there is eventually nobody outside that circle, that it is just us. So to be an image bearer and to be connected to and living in a world with lots of other image bearers means that I have to treat them differently, particularly if he's my God and Jesus is my Savior, right? It also means that as an image bearer, I reflect God to others. And if they don't know that they're an image bearer, they need to know that. They need to learn that. But how I reflect God to others is a huge deal. Right? How many people don't come to church because of church hurt? Because you know what those Christians did? Those so-called Christians. I hate that phrase. And so it's a responsibility to be image bearers and to know it.
I was going to say down that line, like my sons, when you see them, they look like me.
No.
Well, at least one of them does. And we're supposed to look like our Father in heaven. But if you look at this spiritually, and I might get shoved back a little bit, this was before the fall in the garden where we were in the image of him, and I think that goes for our character and those types of things too. But as we move forward, there are certainly places in the Bible where it talks about sons of, you know, followers of God and followers of Satan, and being sons of Satan. And I would argue that they are no longer in the image of God, if you look at it from a spiritual sense, and before the fall. After the fall, things change.
So we actually need to take that. We need to keep increasing that circle.
Yeah,
so that
definitely.
There's not.
We don't want anybody outside the circle. But the truth is, there are people
right
outside the circle that are not. No longer in the image of God.
That's why we have a coffee shop.
The sheep and the goats. I don't get to choose who's the sheep and who's the goat.
Right.
And so the net gets cast, regardless of whether we think they deserve it or earn it or whatever or not. Wherever we think, because see, the thing is we don't know.
I'm not saying they deserve it. I'm saying that's what they've chosen.
I understand that, but we don't know that they won't change their mind.
Yeah, we definitely.
And so we keep trying. We just keep trying. Yeah.
Right.
Look at the thief on the cross. We don't know anyone's heart at the end.
Exactly.
Look at me 10 years ago.
I don't know you, but yeah, we'll have that. We'll have those conversations.
I was thinking when you were talking about reflecting. I was thinking, Ben, this is like a dark world, in a sense. We being like reflection or whatever of God, we're being his image and his likeness, like a reflection. I was thinking that would mean that we are to be light in the dark world, or like, you know, as long as we're around, you know, I guess things could be seen better, seen more, like, you know, the light. You know, what's that scriptures? You shouldn't. That's basic. Yeah, saying shouldn't have your light under a bushel or basket or something like that. To have it on the hill so it can illuminate everywhere, so you'll be able to.
Keep this going. I'm going to start singing this little light of mine. That's where I feel like.
So you'll be able to see things that you normally wouldn't see in the dark. And, you know, when light reflects on it, you can actually see it for what it is, instead of guessing, you know, trying to, you know.
And we need to go be that light,
yeah,
right? To those whose image is so sullied, they've put so much crap on it, right? That, you know, go shine some light and let God clean them up.
Yeah, it makes no more sense to me now.
Yeah. So, other thoughts, because, I mean, we can discuss for forever and a day. I'm trying to be mindful of time and where people are and what people are tracking. I have one on my phone.
I know, but I just recognize it.
We all shared, and it's awesome, and it's wonderful, but you close it up for me, like, just reminding me that I need to see others in that same image, no matter what.
You should know I'm an evangelist at heart. I'm a teacher and an evangelist, and so there are times...
A great reminder.
Not everybody I meet, oh, really? I gotta... Can't somebody else? No. It's an impulse that I need to fight a lot. But it's one of the things about living with folks in the margins. This is also Greg Boyle stuff. You go to change the margins. You go to the margins to be changed. And my view of other people as image bearers and of their worth. Because trust me, I didn't think this about people when I first started doing this stuff. Having lived now in the margins for a good 12 years, my views of people and who I love and how I love has radically changed. And really what I want, I'm an extrovert. I like to hang out with people, and what I really, in some small sense, I want a party. I want Ephraim on keyboards.
Yeah.
And I could run other people who play instruments and sing, but I want to see a party. And I want all my friends to know to be in that party. Right? Because God talks about, you know, we are headed to a banquet. We are headed to a feast. We are headed to a really good time. And I wanted, you know, I want my friends to be there. And the only friends I don't have are people I haven't met yet. So we try not to avoid people, even though I really don't have time for this, right? Try to reflect well what Father has given us to be. And this is where I think also the idea of becoming little Christ, which is what the idea of Christian, the word when given to them in Antioch, little Christ. How do we be more and more like him that others might also be attracted to? Right? Because if I be lifted up, I will draw men to myself, is what Jesus says, like the serpent on the post. We lift up Jesus. And it's not, let me tell you about Jesus, let me show you Jesus, let me try and be like Jesus, let me encourage. So that's the heart of evangelism. That's the heart of the Great Commission. Make disciples. That's the imperative. We do it by going, teaching, baptizing. We do it by living life with people and being really good reflections of who God is. Being nice, shiny, nice, shiny image bearers that give God glory.
Last thoughts? Well, then let me pray, because I'm otherwise going to start singing, and that's not nice to you all.
Yeah, no, don't
say. So, Heavenly Father, we thank you for making us in your image, and for the responsibility and the joy that you have given us to reflect your image to others. We thank you for your word and for your Son, and for the presence of the Spirit with us. Would you continue to shape us, to clean us up so that we might be better reflections of you? Would you give us eyes to see those that you would have us see, ears to hear and listen, hands that are willing to serve and love, that we might get to know more image bearers, that there might be a big party, that your house might be full for the celebration, for the feast. We ask all of this in Jesus' mighty and powerful name. Amen. So, go in peace to love and serve the Lord.